This morning we're continuing our readings, our series together this morning in Romans chapter 8, beginning at verse 26. Read with me Romans chapter 8, verse 26. I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. As God who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to His purpose. For those who He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, in order that He might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom He predestined, He also called. And those whom He called, He also justified. And those whom He justified, He also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not withhold His own Son, but gave Him up for all of us, will He not with Him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. He is to condemn. It is Christ Jesus who died. Yes, He was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, perils, or the sword? And it is just written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. Knowing all things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither life nor death, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This morning I want to use for a subject, I believe I hang on in there. I will hang on in there. Let us pray. My Lord, my God, a comforter and our friend, we thank You this morning for life, health, and strength. As I stand here this morning, oh God, prepared to deliver a word, I ask that You would just speak, God, for Thy servant is listening. Lord, allow me to preach with power and authority. Allow me to be able to preach in clarity, oh God, that someone may see they need You in the midst of their situation. So now come, Holy Spirit. Come, Heavenly Dove. Envelop me, oh God, that I may be able to speak to these Your people. It is in Him whose name is above every name, my Lord and Savior Jesus, whom we all know is the Christ. Amen and amen. Sometimes in the midst of what we are experiencing, somewhere someone needs to be encouraged just to hang in there. As I think about the current context in which we find ourselves living during this season, whether you are here in DC, North Carolina, California, or South America, the season of COVID-19 and the present historic oppressive heat that appears to be grasping the country, someone needs to be encouraged to hang on in there. It is okay. You don't have to worry about exposing the reality or the thoughts that are going through your head. But it marks some people that as we were temporarily reclosed, living in a restrictive lifestyle or staying within our homes and limiting our social interactions, some of us thought that would only be for a few weeks. And now it's 4 months later. Things appear to be trending in the wrong direction. Employment benefits look like they may be cut. And just when you thought nothing else could go wrong, some of us are forced to be teachers a little longer, modifying our schedules at work with a boss that sometimes does not understand. And while you love the Lord and understand His word, you have casted all your trust upon Him. You are looking at the screen this morning because you need someone to encourage you to hang on in there. You're not by yourself. The entire world is experiencing a cataclysmic shift in the daily operational practices of what used to be the norm. And despite how much we want to go back to what used to be, the reality is this is a new day. Because tomorrow is nothing but a memory. And although we don't know what tomorrow holds, we do know who holds tomorrow. And I woke up this morning to tell you to hang on in there. This season of worldly uncertainty did not take our God by surprise. And although everything is shifting by the minute and being updated by the day, there is some consistency in that God is still on the throne. And because he never changes and is always the same, despite what it looks like, I came to tell you to hang on in there. The encouragement to hang on in there presupposes that the one who is encouraged to hold on until change comes has been introduced to what will be their anchor. Over these past few weeks, we have been journeying through the mind of Paul and his writings to the people of Rome. And while sometimes a series is uniquely planned set of scripture that leads to our point of destination, every now and then God charts a path through his divine framework of the scriptures to lead us to a place in which he wants us to experience. Several weeks ago, when I began this dialogue with Paul, it began with the latter part of chapter 7 in Romans, in which we found Paul discussing the struggle between the flesh and the spirit. It is through his unique monologue with himself that we learn that while we all have the law of the flesh working within us, it is the law of the spirit that is able to renew the mind. And although we fall into the traps and we struggle in the flesh, it is the redemptive work of Christ that is able to rescue us from our stuff. That's right, in those verses, Paul is telling us the acceptance of Christ or being in him and he being in us is the first step in getting it together. When we learn to get it together, the opening of chapter 8 compels us to understand that while Christ is the answer to our problems, it won't eliminate the opinions of people. I have to paraphrase a little bit, but as we moved into the concept of deliverance, there had to be an understanding that deliverance is not predicated upon the removal of your circumstances from around you. But deliverance is the ability to still be in the stuff and not be able to hold you in bondage. Paul, through his methodical matriculation of theology, had moved us from the need to accept Christ to rescue us to the ability to be delivered from people. Deliverance, while an experience and a state of freedom, does not come without sacrifice. It was last week when we talked about being a debtor that we learned that deliverance experiences is what experiences that need to be lived, because while God has and can renew our mind, it is not our responsibility to change people. So while folk may still remember the things of the past, the ability for me to live in the now moment of no condemnation requires me to continually be able to pay my dues. In other words, some of us have forgotten about the real reason that we participate in worship experiences. And it was through the middle verses of chapter 8 that we are reminded that worship is not work, but it is our reasonable service. But if Christ died in order that I may live in victory, I can never repay him enough to be able to live in a space where I have no headache. In other words, it's my reasonable service just to be able to lift up the name of Jesus and give him some praise. The life of victory, of the space of deliverance as a Christian, has not only its sacrifices, but it also comes with benefits. And because I'm a child of God, an heir of the promise, and a co-heir with Christ, there are some things that may not seem like they are available to me that I should be able to speak into existence, because that is how I'm able to share in his glory. But sometimes while I know I am his and he is mine, the current chaotic environment or what sometimes I experience on this journey sometimes make me think that I may not be who he purposed me to be. And I know some of you have been home for months, unable to travel like you normally would during this season. And while you love everyone in your house, it feels like the walls are closing in. You don't have to tell anyone, but love the Lord and truthfully give him everything you have and tell the truth. Things really aren't that bad for you right now, but some of us are tired of being in one place, listening to the crazy antics of the lunacy of a person who has a position and power that is dwarfed by the ill-perceived perceptions of the mind. Some of you sitting in your house love the Lord, but you can't take another mishap, mistake, or misunderstanding. And while you haven't said anything to anybody, just like Grandmaster Flash said back in the day, because of what you're going through, it's almost at a point you're telling yourself and other people, don't push me, because I'm close to the edge. And literally, I'm trying not to lose my head. But I have a word for you this morning. No matter what it looks like, hang on in there. That is what Paul is saying in our pericope this morning when we begin verse 26, because while Paul has already talked about the importance of knowing and being in Christ, sometimes we need help to understand what we are to do when we are in vulnerable places. It is the place of vulnerability that we find that the Spirit is able to help us in our weakness. Read verse 26 and look at it later. The power in the Spirit assisting or prompting us in our weakness is that which assists us to be able to be better able to direct our prayers toward the Creator in absence of totally being focused on the creation. Paul uses these verses to remind the believer that despite the vulnerable conditions, your vulnerable position, the current contextual environment that you are experiencing, that if you belong to God and if you belong to him, all you have to do is love him through everything you're going through, and it is going to be all right. This precept and example is spoken to the believer because in the midst of this pandemic, economic uncertainty, and social injustices, there should be a calm assurance among believers about everything that is going on because we literally understand who we are. There is a confidence or a boldness that is expressed among believers in the times of crises because there is consistency in the one who anchors our faith. When there is consistency in the one who anchors our faith, we are less concerned about what we see and what is going on, because as believers, we understand that if we can see it, it can change. If it is in my view, it has the potential to be out of my way. So our prayer life is predicated on what is happening around us when we're not rooted in God and we're not praying in the Spirit. But when we allow the Spirit to intercede for us, our prayer is rooted in not in the things that we see, but our prayer is rooted in the things that has not been revealed yet. So while people are panicking, believers, listen, believers are preparing for victory because we already understand that if I am in Christ and he is in me, then I am more than a conqueror. And if Christ has already conquered a sin, then right there in the midst of of this pandemic, victory is already mine. Therefore, I will not be consumed about what I'm going to do when school starts back and my schedule isn't certain. I will not be consumed about being back in a building when God's people are continuing to get the word. I will not be consumed about tomorrow because tomorrow is not promised, but it's in the hands of God. I will not be consumed about what I don't have because I have a Father who has everything in his hands. I will not be consumed about stuff I cannot change because I understand that if God be for me, who can be against me? Am I talking to somebody out there that understand that if I hang on in there and start preparing for victory, that everything will be all right? I don't know about you, but I'm going to do like that old song to say, victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan to get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Therefore, in all things, I will enter into his gates with thanksgiving. I will come into his courts with praise. A few things that we're going to be out of here. One of the first reasons that we understand through this text that we are encouraged to hang in there is because literally prayer works. Read verse 26 and 27. These verses are giving the outline and the structure for powerful prayer that yields results. The one only thing you have to do is get out of your own way. These verses declare that the Spirit will help us in our weakness because we don't know what we ought to pray for. I know some people may think into themselves that they know what they need. They know exactly what they want God to do. They know exactly what needs to be manifested in your life. But when you are in a vulnerable or a weak place that is specified time that you need to get out of something, we got to realize that our flesh is doing all the asking. Whether we know it or not, we can get weak mentally, emotionally, and physically, so much that we don't have the Spirit interceding for us, and we could be asking for the wrong things. You know what I'm talking about. It's saying stuff like, God, deal with them. God, deal with him. God, remove them from my job. God, if you just change their mind. God, if you just move them out the way. God, if you just fix this situation. And the reality is, while we want to be relieved from a condition, it is only God that knows the mind of the Spirit, and he searches our heart, which brings truth to our awareness. And the reason that the prayers of the righteous avail as much is because when we pray right, and God is interceding for us, he's going to deal with you first. When we understand that he in verse 27 is God the omnipotent, God the omniscient, and God the omnipresent, the totality and reality of who God really is will manifest itself in your life to understand that you can be here and God will be over there moving on your behalf. You can begin to understand that if you can pray with boldness and power and authority, because you have to understand that if God said it, it is already done. You will have to understand that God is omnipresent. You can leave situations with the peace that passeth all understanding, because while you may have left hell at home, you can be in one place and God has already changed it over there. You got to know who the he is, and it is God who will supply your every need, make a way out of no way. Hang on in there, because while it may feel like nothing is happening, a change is on the way. Is anybody out there got a prayer life? Anybody knows how to talk to the Lord? Anybody knows that you have to push past your stuff and do like the old folk used to say? I need to have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about my troubles. He will hear my faintest cry. He will answer by and by. And after a while you feel a prayer wheel turning, and then you know it's a little fire burning. Have a little talk with Jesus. It'll make it all right. Somebody ought to to say, I know that's right. He is talking to me right there. When you hang on in there, despite what is happening all around you, it demonstrates not only a good prayer life, but it then begins to reveal who you really are. The main problem with people who are inconsistent in their faith, fall apart in every situation, is that they have misplaced their identity. Verse 28 states that we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. In other words, if you are in Christ and Christ is in you, that literally means that whatever you are experiencing, that God is in the middle of it. So while we may be going through the season where we don't know what is going to happen in our life, the reason that we can't curse our current circumstance is because at some point I have to understand that although I really don't get it, God is working it out for my good. The reason he's working it out for my good is because he is in the middle of it. And the last time they put Christ in the middle of something that looked like it might take him out, somebody ought to say 3 days later, he got up out of the grave. When you are a child of God, you have to know how to speak to situations that look like it wants to kill you. Because instead of running from it, running from the problems, problems should be running from you. Because when God gets through with you, in the end, he is going to get the glory. That is what Paul meant when he said, if God knew you before he formed and shaped you in your mother's womb, if you could just hang on in there, he called you despite what others may say or think. Will justify you. I will make you right, not in the sight of people, but I will make you right in the sight of God. Then eventually glory will be revealed. So how dare you say love God and won't praise through your stuff? If God can be for you, who shall be against you? Sometimes you have to learn how to do like Isaac Korea and praise him in the middle of it. You're not crazy because you're praising him in the midst of the storm. You're giving God praise because you know he's already brought you the victory. And although the thunder may be rolling, the lightning may be flashing, the wind may be blowing, I'm giving God praise because as long as he's with me, everything will be all right. Ask me how I know, because he walks with me, he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. As long as I got Jesus, everything will be all right. Anybody got Jesus in the middle of it? Go ahead and say, I got him. I'm going to give him praise. Even if I can't see my way, I'm going to tell him thank you. I don't know what tomorrow's going to bring. I'm going to tell him thank you. God is not through with you yet. You got to know how to hang on in there. Prayer works. Not only does prayer work, not only do you need to know your identity, the last point of hanging in there is that you already know the outcome of the situation. When you are in the middle of something and you're already certain of what the outcome is going to be, nothing should be able to distract you from your destination. Our destiny is to be with the Lord. And the same way we sometimes experience detours and derails in our travels, we must understand that sometimes there will be hiccups and hangups along the journey. Somebody ought to go ahead and say there'll be bumps in the road. Every now and then I might get in a traffic jam, but as long as I keep right on pushing, I get to where the Lord wants me to be. But if you're certain of what you're looking for, whatever you're looking for, you will keep going because you know that it'll be there if you can just stay on the journey. One time we were traveling to a destination, and it appeared as if it would take hours to get out of D.C. I mean, anybody who lives in the DMV area already knows and understands you do not take 95 any day south, but particularly you don't drive 95 south on a Friday. And we were headed to North Carolina, and we were in Rockville. And I remember being in Rockville, and normally from my house, I would get on 301 to go around the traffic so I wouldn't be in 95. But Wade says, go on 95. It was a smooth ride for a little bit until we got just then downtown almost, all going across the bridge, and eventually you get into Springfield. Everybody here knows it's the mixing bowl, and it was a mixed up mess. It took 4 hours to get out of that mix up. I began to wonder and get frustrated at ways because I said I could go back home and we could just leave in the morning. But my wife and them was encouraging. She said, we really don't got to be there until this time tomorrow, so we might as well keep going. And when I thought about what we were going to do, although it was going to take a little bit longer, I said I might as well stay on the road, even though I'm going to be a little bit distracted. I came to tell somebody today that I am convinced that nothing is going to separate me from getting to my journey. I don't know about you, but at the end of all of this, when COVID is over, when social injustice is done, when they stop liking us because of the color of our skin, when we all get through these trials and tribulations, I don't know about you, but I want to be able to see Jesus. That's why Paul says, therefore I am convinced that neither life nor death, angels nor demons, present nor the future, powers nor even height nor depth. I came to tell somebody that no social distancing, number 45, nobody is going to separate us from the love of God, because no matter what it looks like, I'm going to hang on in there. I'm going to see what tomorrow is going to bring, because just like the old hymn writer said, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Anybody gonna try Jesus? Don't let nothing separate you from the love of God. Oh, I came to tell somebody today that even though it may be rough, hang right on in there. Because if you hang on in there, everything is going to be all right. Oh, I hope this was an encouraging word for somebody out there this morning. I'm going to do like what Paul just encouraged. I'm not going to let anything separate me from the love of God. Hang on in there. Paul said it at the close of this verses. He's convinced now that no matter what it looks like, death nor life, angels nor demons, past nor the present, powers, height, death, nothing is going to separate me from the love of God. I pray that nothing separates you from His love on this morning. Whatever you're going through, whatever you need, I know God has it, because all things are possible with Him. As we leave this moment, you just hold on and know it's going to be all right. You just got to hang on in there until your change comes. I know that was a song not too long ago that was just released that they sang. A lot of big care and shit. Just hang on in there, you know, because everything is going to be all right. Hang on in there. COVID is going to be over. Eventually, we're going to be able to go to our destinations. Eventually, times like these are going to pass. But all you need to do is be in Christ Jesus. He lives in you. When you get through that, pray in such a way that you're able for the Spirit to intercede on your behalf. When He intercedes on your behalf, I believe then it reminds you of your identity, of who you really are, because you are more than a conqueror. Don't you understand that? You overcome overcoming. That's what a conqueror is. You won't even smell like what you've been through when you come out. And that's a enough right there to give God some praise. And why we can praise him like this while we're in the middle of it, because I already seen the end. I know what the end is going to be, because he promised that he will take care of everything. My God is an omniscient God. My God is an omnipotent God. My God is an omnipresent God. And because he is all these things, all things are going to work out for good of them that love the Lord and for those who are called according to his purpose. So this morning, if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, come on today, make that decision. I'm talking to you. You may have thought you have had a relationship with him, but have you deepened your relationship to the point that you're able to praise him in the middle of it, that you're able to love him through whatever's going on? If that's you, go ahead and put those hands up as you're watching this message on this morning and say, that is for me. I'm turning everything over to him. And if you want to be discipled through this season, through this process, not only reach out when you put your hands up, but inbox us straight to the church so we can demonstrate and show you and disciple you into a closer walk with him. If you accept the Lord as your Savior and you need a church home, I know you could be watching, but you need someplace that you can grow and become whom God would allow you to be. You have reached the right place. Go ahead on today. Shoot that mail right into our inbox and say, you know what? I need to be a member on this morning. I know I may live in North Carolina. I may live in Georgia. You may live in South Africa. It doesn't even matter, because this virtual ministry is able to participate, be so participatory that we will be able to engage with one another every single day of the week to walk you through that process. If you need prayer, send all prayer requests the exact same way, and we'll be glad to lift you up in prayer all week long. There's someone praying early in the morning. We also be praying on Mondays during Bible study. We have it on Tuesdays and on Wednesdays and Thursdays. I believe that the prayers of the righteous avail much. And we're going to pray for you right now. Even as you type in those prayer requests as you're watching this feed, we're going to pray that your mind is regulated. We're praying that you'll be able to move into a deeper space with the Lord. We're going to pray that every obstacle in your way to move out. But particularly, we're going to pray for your mind. That's anything that's preventing you from getting closer to him, that it be removed in the name of Jesus. We're going to pray that the pain or hurt that you're experiencing on the inside that's maybe preventing you from growing and becoming who God would have you to be, we're going to ask it be removed on this morning. We're praying for you, not that everything around you change, but everything in you change, so that you can react different to what's around you. Because when you act different, they will treat you different, and then you will know what it's like to be delivered. Deliverance is on the way. We thank you for it right now in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is the Christ. For every prayer request that's being typed, every prayer request that's being listed, every new member that's reaching out and deciding that this is where they need to be, every person who may be saying, I need a closer relationship with him, do it right now, Jesus, because you are God, and beside you there is none other. And we give you praise in the middle of it, because we've already seen the outcome, and you've worked it out for our good. So for that, we give you praise. This is our prayer in the name of him whose name is above every name. Some call him Jehovah Jireh. Some may say Jehovah Rapha. Some may know him as Elohim. Some may say he is the great I am. Some may know him as Jehovah Jireh. We simply know him as Jesus, who is the Christ. And you are right there with us. So we give it to you, and we acknowledge you, and we lift up thy holy name, and we count it all done. Amen and amen. We pray that this message was for you. We pray that you come back and worship and visit with us again right here at 3505 16th Street Northwest, Washington, D.C. And we pray that you're able to continue to support ministry. And as we do this, we want to be a blessing outside these walls. We look forward to worshiping you at the Trinity Church, where we believe in equipping minds, empowering people, and embracing worship. Until next week, amen.